Okay, my name is Robert Bucky. I'm Commissioner District 3, Representative for Queen Anne's County, and this is my roundtable on voting by district. And I kind of want to get it out to the public. My view, also people that I respect in the community's view on why voting by district would be bad for Queen Anne's County. So if we can do that, I want to introduce Tim Kingston, the Republican Chair for the Central Committee.
Correct.
Past County Commissioner George O'Donnell, which I truly respect, and is somebody that, you know, I consult with on a regular basis. My colleague, Steve Wilson, Commissioner Wilson of District 2, and Barbara Ober from, you actually live in District 4.
Mm-hmm.
You were on a chair appointed by George O'Donnell in 2000 to chair a group similar to this, what we're going through now, right?
Yeah, absolutely I was. In fact, I was appointed by all three commissioners at that time to serve on the advisory board that determined the way we get elected today. There are 11 of us on the board, and after we worked together, it was actually that board of citizens from across the county that elected me to then be the chair. So it was pretty representative.
Right. And you've gone through this before.
I have gone through this before. You know, there was a straw poll before that,
right,
that got us to the point of taking steps to change the way we elected commissioners in the county. It was a 2-year thoughtful process and very thoughtful process. And that is exactly what brought us to the way we've been electing commissioners for 4 elections
since
now.
206 years, I believe, we've been electing commissioners in this county that way.
Absolutely.
So
That's not why we
right,
made the recommendation we did, but it's turned out right, that is the best way. So I have a question for you, Commissioner.
Absolutely.
Can I?
Sure.
Okay.
That's what this is for.
Well, you know, the process that we went through before was a process where citizens gave input and gave a choice. But I noticed that you wrote a letter.
Right.
You wrote a letter in support of going to a straw poll. You also said that you didn't agree with changing the method we do. I really want to know why you wrote the letter.
That's a great question. And yeah, I answer this almost on a daily basis when I run into citizens. My philosophy at the time was, I felt that I as a commissioner should hear what the citizens of this county have to say. I do not support voting by district. And in my letter I sent to the delegate, it specifically said, I do not support voting by district. And I believe there was another one, staggered terms, but I do respect hearing what the people have to say. So that's my reasoning for doing the letter. I don't support this mm-hmm. motion. That's why I have this here now. I'll do everything I can to stop this. I think it's a bad idea for this county to vote by district, and I think we'll get into that reasoning with the intelligence we have at this table. I hope that satisfies your question.
Since that time, I think you've heard a lot more of what the people have to say and,
and
a lot
absolutely
more facts behind
absolutely
what we do today.
Yeah.
Good.
Barbara, can I interrupt for a second?
Yeah, sure.
Can you explain to everyone how we currently elect commissioners?
Sure, absolutely. The way we elect commissioners, we have 5 commissioners. All 5 are elected by everybody in the county. One is at large, is an at large commissioner, so serves at large. The other 4 are each reside in a district of the county, districts 1, 2, 3, and 4. But they're elected by everybody. So every voter has the chance to cast 5 votes. And that method was selected after reviewing all kinds of methods, including electing by district,
okay,
because all 5 commissioners have to vote on every issue in the county, every issue that comes across. So they need to understand the issues. They need to understand that they can't trade off one for the other. They can't just be protectionist of their district. They're going to be voting on things that impact everybody. That's why everybody elects them.
Thank you.
Good. Let me ask you real quick to go into that. Were there several recommendations on the way to do it at that time?
Yes, absolutely. We considered, probably
we considered
probably a dozen different recommendations. We had the full county resources that shared every kind of data and statistic. We toured the county. Now, mind you, this group of 11 people We had farmers, we had stay-at-home moms who were going back to school, we had all kinds of people from all walks of life, Democrats and Republican, and we considered every possible option. Also, a mix of races. Really, we considered every possible option, and the one we recommended and the one we use today was really considered to be the best.
And that seems to be a very intelligent approach the way you did it back in 2000. You know, I don't want to talk about the way it's being done now, but it just seems to be more... You guys did more research, it seems to me, than what's been put together recently to... for this push for district voting. It just,
if you go through a thoughtful two-year process rather than a vote in an election where you look at, you know, I've seen ads out there already, vote this way, vote that way. And if you go through a thoughtful two-year process representing all the citizens, you know, on this board, rather than, oh, I believe what it says in this ad and I haven't seen the others.
Right.
That seems like a sounder way to determine how folks are elected.
All right, I would agree with you. George, Steve, why don't you jump in there? Hey, tell me how you guys feel. Give me your thoughts.
Well, the premise of the money question about people getting elected using their own resources, and certainly there's no ban on that. You can spend as much money as you want to run your campaign. If you're a person like me who pledged to their family not to use a dime, because I'm a true fiscal conservative, especially with my own resources, I raised the money. There's no limit to what you can raise. I raised $300,000 for the Waterman's Monument that down the Kenton Arrow, so you could raise everything. I didn't use a dime. However, I ran against a man that had many more times the wealth of myself and 20 years' experience in politics. Now, if you listen to some of these premises being brought forth by folks who think that district voting is a superior way to do things, it would have been impossible for me to not only get elected, but get reelected. Now, how could that happen? So it happens because it's based on the campaign you run.
Right.
You have to be a sale. You have to sell yourself to the citizens of this county. And to create fiefdoms by having district voting, to me, makes no sense. It would create such a competition for capital dollars. We've always voted on capital. We did 36 major capital projects the 8 years I served. And that's when, as a working person, I found a way to meet on a weekly basis. I attended 400 county commissioner meetings. I missed three. And I was president of the board for five of the 8 years. I have yet to find what the upside is and what problem it corrects by going to district voting. I don't think it sounds real democratic to take the five-vote process you have now and reduce that to two votes. The majority of the board, citizens, no citizens of this county would have an effect on who the majority of the board are going to be. I don't know how that is supposed to be a superior process. You can shape these things any way you want them. As Barbara said, there were a number of different iterations. I personally didn't think we needed to go to five commissioners. District would have been fine, and what brought that about was I was on the last board of three commissioners, and we ran completely at large with no districts. Okay, well, and it just so happened that two commissioners were from Queenstown, Ms. Davis and myself. Mr. McQueenie was from Kent Island, so the notion was, well, there's nobody up here. Well, there were reasons for that, I think, in the way that the election unfolded, but anybody could have voted for anybody. Whoever had the three most votes were the commissioners, and I went through two elections like that. So to somehow say that if I were the commissioner from Barbara's district in four, why would I ever go to the first district to find out what those folks were interested in, what they want? What would I base my votes on for their service needs?
Right.
I would never go. Why would you go up there? You have no incentive to go there.
Right.
In fact, they'd probably want to know why you're up here. You're my kid. But one vote on a board, you have to have a plurality of votes. So I have always thought, and we thought then, and I feel the same way now, probably even more strongly after looking at it over the years, that it makes it doesn't serve the democratic process very well to take away votes from the electorate. Let citizens weigh in throughout the county. So it's an equal balance from each district has 12,000 people in it. So whether you're from Crumpton or Kent Point, you can vote on the old iterations. Let folks go through the county, and to subsidize a low energy person who only wants to run in one district, why would I want to do that? If you don't have enough time, say, or resources to go throughout this county, most likely you should find something else to do. because for several hundred years we found a better way to manage the business of the citizens here, and in that large sense has always been a premier way to do it.
Do you mind, Commissioner Buckey? I actually have a question. Sure. You just talked about time, and you mentioned earlier that you attended 400 commissioner meetings. Okay. So obviously you had to prepare and study and review documents and talk to folks in preparation for those meetings. Would you say that time is really the most critical issue in why somebody does or doesn't run for office or choose to serve in office? And we have two other standing commissioners.
Yes, there is no question on the time component. And we didn't have five people to divide the job up, then there was three. But we found time to do it because you should have your life constructed in such a way where you can do it. Now, nobody, until you get the job, truly knows what it fully entails. How do you know how many calls you're going to get at home on any given issue and things like that? Sure, you know, you go to Centerville on Tuesdays, and so we usually take a couple meeting days off, one around the holidays, one in the summer. We attended around 49-50 meetings a year, and now it's a different structure. Now, I can tell you that there was a lot going on in the county. We were in a growth spurt when I was county commissioner. We averaged 424 new homes in the county area outside of municipalities for eight straight years. Now it's 135. So all those are public works agreements, additional meetings, road boards meetings. It was a very consuming time, and still found time to do 36 major capital projects, inclusive of the 911 center, Cross Island Trail, quadrupling the parks, Kent Island High School, Mattapique Elementary, the Chesapeake Exploration Center, to name just several of those.
I think you're touting your accomplishments, George, is what's going on here.
You're going to have to run again. Well, not mine, we had a lot of help.
So bottom line, teachers and farmers and firemen and business owners and investors and retirees can serve in office if they find the time.
Oh, absolutely. You're not.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I interrupted.
It's okay. No, it's okay.
I think one of the things that gave me a slight advantage over time was the fact that I was born in Queen Anne's County. I spent my 59 years now. I know I don't look that old, but I spent 59 years here. And since 1839, we've called Graysonville home. We move about a mile every 50 years. I've slowly got
you
to Chester.
You lived here since 1839?
My family has. my family has. But so I just think that when you go to school with every high school student in this county, because right down the street, Queen Anne's County High School, I graduated from there in 75. So it gave me a real base of knowledge. And no one had to explain to me where the Dixon Furniture Auction was, where
right.
any of the land, where's Johnston sure. School. I knew these things. So.
Stevie, what do you think, sir?
Rather than do this in terms of sort of personal experience, I want to talk a little about the theory of it.
Sure.
That at the moment, we have a form of government in which the commissioners work cooperatively. And we're all working for the good of Queen Anne's County as a whole. What district voting would do would be to turn each district into a competing entity which had to work against each other, and it fundamentally changes the relationship of how the commissioners and the districts work with each other from one that's cooperative to one that's competitive. And now what becomes the greatest vote getter is bringing home the bacon, whatever the bacon may be. The bacon may be a school, it could be roads, it could be some sort of tax relief, it could be farm. But you wind up with very many peculiar unintended consequences. In theory, what should happen is that districts, the argument is made, for instance, that commissioners under that system would have to work with each other. But you find that very often in groups like this, they don't. That you get, shall we say, consortiums or alliances of two or three against two or three of others. And in a term like that, the districts that were in the minority would get deprived of the resources that the county should be equally distributing. And under the system we've had, I have been watching this government or involved in it for as long as George, which is to say close to 30 years. And I have never seen where districts were really over a period of time unfairly treated. So to an extent, this district voting argument is curing a problem that doesn't exist, but it's going to exist if we get district voting.
And I would agree with you.
Because it's going to lead to an unequal distribution of resources as the more powerful commissioners or the ones with the better alliances are able to bring home more bacon in order to win their next election.
There'll be a lot of pork belly trading, in other words, behind closed doors.
It's going to bring the Washington-style trading our county. And
look,
we don't
what's
need
happened
that.
In the House of Representatives, where nothing almost can get through because you cannot dare to vote against your district.
Right
now, if I think there's something that's good for the county but not good for Centerville, I have no trouble saying I think it's not a good idea. But in this new form of government, I would have to push for Centerville at the expense of the county. And that's not a good thing when you're not able to voice what should be the add to the intelligence of this intellectual community of people that's supposedly running things. A second problem you have is, in order to do this fairly, you have to square up so that every district has the same population in it.
Right.
This raises an enormous question. We only do censuses every 10 years. But in order to have one man, one vote, you're going to have to move the district lines in order to even out the district so that each commissioner represents the same number of people. I've talked to Brittany about this. It's not something that is going to be less than cumbrous for her to deal with. If you move, let's say, a Four Seasons in, how do we deal with that? With a high voting group of people, do we now move the boundary in or out in order to square up the number? Try another argument. If this business of trading amongst the districts, how do you trade something like the sewer, which is a $50 million deal? How do you trade a YMCA when there's nothing to trade for? You can trade roads, but no other district other than four has a $50 million problem like the sewer, so it's an untradeable thing. And that the argument you've got to trade doesn't work at all.
Right.
I mean, you can see time after time where this is absolutely a flawed idea, that if you went to look at what the realities of it are going to be after it comes into being, they're going to make this county a much more difficult situation to get cooperative and good government.
I would agree 100%.
Indeed.
You know, when you talk about the trading that goes on, I went and I testified against this, I'll tell you, over in Annapolis when it was proposed in the spring. And one of the things I commented on was that the folks who proposed it, the folks testifying for it, none of them were from District 4. And in fact, District 3, your district, was barely represented. So it already is showing signs of how can we change the system to better benefit our district, because the ones who proposed it were not from the districts.
Let me say this. You know, a lot of people that know me know I'm kind of a conspiracy type of person. I don't know why I am, but I am what I am, and it is what it is. One of my first actions I took as a county commissioner was to reverse the last set of commissioners' decision to vote by district. Okay? Does everybody remember that? Mm-hmm. The last set on the last day of the office voted to vote by district. And we came in and changed that. I think it was a 4-1 vote. Commissioner Moran voted against it. Me, Paul Comfort, Steve Wilson, and Mark Anderson voted in favor to kill that. There was a reason for that, obviously. I say this because, to me, this whole thing has come about because certain people that ran, some people feel that they had this money, and money can buy a seat. Well, let me tell you, from sitting from this seat here, maybe it can't. You know, I hired a campaign strategist, and he's a big dollar guy, okay? And I respect the guy tremendously, but what I know now, what I have hired him, and what I had spent the kind of money I spent, absolutely not. I wouldn't have, because I don't need to. Now that I know what I'm doing, I could run an election again probably for 20 grand countywide, knowing I can do it myself. But the key here is, I think this all got put together because of the way the last vote was turned out. I think there were some people upset simply that myself, Commissioner Wilson, and Mark Anderson were sitting in the chairs that we're sitting in, and they felt we bought these chairs. And I'm going to tell you, we didn't buy these chairs. Commissioner Wilson walked with me multiple times, knocking on doors. Commissioner Anderson walked with me until he was blue and he couldn't walk anymore. I used to make Commissioner Anderson get in my car with me and Jack Wilson and knock on doors. I knocked on doors with Jack Wilson from north to south. So I know what it takes to run, and I agree with George when he made a comment earlier. I'm not just representing District 3. I'm a county commissioner that has to make a decision for this entire county. If I only had to represent District 3, well, then, you know what? I would have a lot of no votes up there, you know, because there's nothing coming to my district as horse trading, per se, is what we're talking about, horse trading here,
sure.
I guess. So, look.
You know,
do you see where I'm going with this?
I actually do, Bucky. I'm more of a numbers guy.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So I've heard certain arguments about representation and representation.
Right.
We don't, you know, the northern side of the county doesn't feel that they're getting everything that they want and need. So you go back and you pull the numbers.
Right.
And the numbers showed in the primary of 2014 that Paul Comfort not only won countywide, the citizens of District 1, which he resides and represented, voted him in. You go back one set of commissioners prior to that, Dave Dunmeyer not only won countywide, but the citizens of District 1, he voted him in there. So what we have is not a voter representation issue.
Right.
It's a voter turnout issue.
Exactly.
You know, I had a meeting when I first took over as chair of the Central Committee with Bill up in Sudlersville. And we went out and we had dinner and we were talking about this whole thing. And in 2014 in the primary, there was a little over 700 potential Republican voters. He had less than 24%. 212 showed up.
In District 1.
In District 1 for Sudlersville. If, you know, and we know that race, and that was in fact your race, you know, that there was a very close primary that you had. Yeah, well, if he had 200 more people, it could have, in fact, changed the outcome or enhanced your race. You know, we just don't know. So it is a voter turnout. At the end of the day, this is just bad government. It
right.
doesn't represent the people. In fact, we would say on the Central Committee, we would say it's a matter of a certain small minority trying to steal your votes.
Right.
All the commissioners, all of you, serve and wear two hats, your executive and your legislative branch. You make budgets under the executive branch. You pass laws and ordinances that affect us countywide.
That's the key, okay. Countywide. Not just my district or District 2, but countywide.
Absolutely. You place people on boards and commissions that develop where we're going as a society here in Queen Anne's County. So everyone is affected by both your actions, Stevie, and yours, Bucky, and the rest of the commissioners. So why would we try to take their votes?
Okay, well, then that goes into my point. Where is it that if we vote by district, commissioners are going to get along better? There's five individuals at this table, and let's say we're all county commissioners representing our districts here, and Barbara's here at large, and Commissioner Wilson wants to pave District 2, okay? I'm just using it as an example. Doesn't benefit my guys that live in District 3. I'm going to say no to that. So I don't see the notion of having voting by district, we're going to work better together. Unless there's horse trading behind the scene. Unless I go to Stevie and say, okay, you know, you want to pave Centerville, you know, okay, cool with that. But I want an $8 million community center in District 3. So I either want you to vote yes or I want you to abstain, something like that. I see, as you say, this is going to be bad government. And this is what's going to be happening because it's not happening now. And you got two commissioners here. I don't work deals out with Stevie, and Stevie doesn't work them out with me, and I don't work them out with any other commissioner, and I'm on tape here.
Sure.
You know, I don't call Commissioner Moran or Commissioner Anderson or the other Wilson and say, if you do this, I'll do that. I think about the county as a whole. You know, I use the sewer as an example. I hate to because it's behind us now. To me, that's a done battle. I'm not going to use the sewer. I'm going to give you a good one. I'm going to use the courthouse. Okay. One of the reasons why I voted against the courthouse, one was that it's expensive. Okay. Two, it's going to be a building that looks like it belongs on Constitution Avenue. But most importantly, it could be tied with number one, is that maybe 20% of the citizens of this county will use that facility. And we just spent $25 million on a courthouse. Mm-hmm. So how voting by district would have made that better? I don't get it. don't get the idea there. If we were all district commissioners, I would have said, hold on, I want that courthouse in my district, you know?
Well, you look at things that serve a limited set. Let's look at the middle school up in Sudlersville.
Right.
So that school is gorgeous. It's a great facility. It's award-winning, and it's up in Sudlersville. So it's serving the kids of the area, and Board of Commissioners from across the county had to vote on the budget that was being asked for that would allow that to be built to serve the students up in that area. And that's a great example of collaboration.
Let me intrude on your argument a little. Not only did they have to vote, they did vote. And the majority of tax revenue in this county comes from District 4 and to a lesser extent District 2 and District 1 the least. And there has never been any discussion of the supply of money. It's always been distributed by need, not by source. And that is an incredibly important part. And if this business of district voting is a good idea, which it isn't, then if it's really good, why do we have you at all? You're at large. You're
right.
Not representing a district, so leave.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
There are so many unintended consequences to this, which are going to be destructive and which are not going to be in the public good, that it seems very easy to dismiss this to me.
Right. Well, look, you look at Anne Arundel County, they're not commissioners, they're council members.
Correct.
And their executive, I believe, is not appointed. He has to run for office.
That's correct.
So to me, if you're going to go by a district type of system, then, as you said, the at-large, what's the at-large represent? So he represents, so he's the better commissioner? You know, oh, I represent the entire county because I don't just represent one district. Now, I agree with you. I think the at-large probably needs to go. And probably if we go to this type of system, to me, it's like a council type of system. I think we have to elect our executive as well. Maybe the at-large is the executive of the county. I don't know.
In about 30 years when the population grows, and that's a decision that we can go and look at and, you know, do a study, ask the questions. You know, do this in a professional, non-biased, you know, objective for what's better for the county.
Right.
Okay. Right now, this, in 2000, they said this is no. We looked at it. The citizens came out and said, I don't think so. Okay. I personally, and, you know, again, the Republican Central Committee says this is a bad idea.
Right.
So,
you know, there are council members in the state of Maryland who represent three times the population of our county, just one person. You know, Prince George's comes to mind, and that's Montgomery. Montgomery is 22 times the population. It takes 22 Queen Anne's County population to make one Montgomery County.
Oh.
So when you look at us, you wonder, where has it gone? When I look back, if I would do it all over again, I, of course, was very opposed to going to five county commissioners personally.
Right.
It met the burden I said it had to meet for me to support going the other way. And of course, only two of us supported it. And I would have done, because the argument seemed to be, well, there's nobody in this big area up the county. I said, well, show me one example of where I did anything to the persons in Crumpton or Kingstown or Sudlersville. I said, so you could have gone to three districts and had three commissioners and been done with it, and then vote at large. There was no need to go to five. That was, looking back, I think, I felt it was a mistake at the time, and I don't know how anybody can make the case anything has improved since then. If you follow the thinking of some of the folks writing in the newspaper, well, you know, we have more people, more debate. Well, if you follow that thinking, we go to 10, we'd have a real good commission then, wouldn't we?
Oh, yeah.
Well, maybe how about 15? 15 would be extraordinary, wouldn't it? We dismissed,
right,
offhand, the Economic Development Commission when I was commissioner. We dissolved it because I've never seen a big board work well.
Right.
The bigger, rarely do you expand government and improve anything. You raise costs, you slow down the process. So therefore, I think as much as I was against the five and I debated it, but it met the burden that I said it had to meet to get my support and apparently Marlene's, where every precinct voted by about 2/3 for that. How you can make, the last budget I signed was $66 million. We found a way to do 36 major capital projects. And oh, by the way, I lived in Queenstown. The majority, you know where the majority of those capital projects were funded? From Centerville North. I didn't live there. It was based on the service needs of the county.
Right.
Now, if you lock yourself in a lockbox in one district, you're completely determined, I guess, on what the staff tells you. Oh, we don't, I don't know how much the staff interacts with folks up and down the county. If you don't go to that, we go to all the installation of officers, as you know, for the fire department. When you go to the grocery store, you allow an extra half hour because a lot of people don't want to stand in front of a camera and stand in front of a microphone if they had the time to do so.
I don't want to forget this point. You made a good point. There's a couple of employees that I've ran into that had mentioned that if this county goes voting by district, mm-hmm. that their job is going to be more complicated. And what they meant by that is simply, I'm Commissioner 3, and I want Barbara Ober. I want you over here in my district doing this today, or something. Mm-hmm. You know, you work for mm-hmm. one of our departments. Steve Wilson's doing the same thing, or Commissioner Anderson, or Commissioner Jack, or you know, the Commissioner at large. I guess he could do it for the entire county, but it could create problems there as well because now it's kind of an easygoing thing. You know, we have an issue with something, we call them up, they take care of it. It's not a priority, say, per district. And as Steve said, you get two or three commissioners in there that can, you know, control the commission, well, they can control how things are done as well, do the way it's being done.
So I'm going to bring up a new and rather obscure point,
sure.
which will interest maybe only the people at this table.
Maybe only you, Steve.
Yeah, sure. What makes you think we'll be interested in
that?
The subject is the offset, which is the amount of money which the county gives back to the towns. Now, remind yourself that this motion seems to have originated from the Council of Governments, which has always had the feeling that their towns are being doubly taxed. We now give back, they have asked for something like 15 cents in Centerville, and we give them 8 or thereabouts. One of the reasons why we can't do more is that any town that wants to put on some sort of pork barrel legislative program could put an ice cream truck and 53 public service employees out, say what a great job we've done, and get the county to pay for it if we paid for 100% of it. So we always have to stay at a fraction, because if we don't, we are now supporting, we become the captive of everything the towns want. And we're in no position to judge that. We are the allocators of the money of the county. We're voting on everybody's money, not that town's. And yet this would throw the control of that if we went to full reimbursement. It would deprive the full body of the citizens of equity of distribution. And that's a very important point.
Yeah, it is. Extremely.
Now, I'm going to spin off on that, you know, Stevie. You know, I sat back and downloaded and watched some of the testimony that Barbara, you did, and some of the gentlemen that wanted this. And the interesting fact is, you know, at one point I was talking to one of the town commissioners, Mr. Rhodes, and I asked him about his last election, where less than 20 people put him in office. You know, and when they were sitting in front of the, you know, legislators, it sounded as if there was a mob behind them. You know, as like there's such a small proportion of individuals that A, know what this is, that know how we vote, that actually support it. And it's just that. It's coming from the municipalities and a select developers that are doing this. So
it's true, but a thing which has always frightened me is the fact that to the public has a general distrust and probably deserved when it comes to general government, of government. And the idea that somehow people are not getting what they wanted if you change this local system, which happens to work quite well, but it's part of government. If you changed it to something else, you would get more of what you want. In fact, that is not the case. But explaining that to the public is complicated because it does have to do with these issues of distribution.
Sure.
And I've always feared that simply out of an inability to explain fairly to the public what was in the good public interest, it was in some ways rather perilous to put in front of the public without a really full explanation of it, because it's hard to explain.
Barbara Ober took 2 years to come up with their notion. Two years.
That process, that whole process from beginning to end, straw poll to the recommendation, two years.
To the commissioners, 2 years. This has been a process of 10 months, if that.
You know,
but it hasn't been a process.
It's been a few ads that have
been thrown up recently.
And I get to the point with that is, I'm afraid, as Commissioner Wilson has mentioned, and I think he's trying to say, I also believe that the citizens aren't going to be informed well enough. I really believe that. There was a sign, I saw it for the first time today, believe it or not, for the first time on Bennett Point and Nesbeck Road. And I think it said, your vote, your choice, your district. Vote yes by district. Well, if I'm just your average Joe that's not into politics, not in this, you know, social media, and I go to work and I cross the bridge, I'm looking at that and I'm going, well, what does that mean? It said question A, yes. Okay, my vote, my question, I'm going to hit that without knowing the consequences of what they just did. And you know, that's the problem here as well.
Let me say one more.
So you're close.
Yeah.
And that's what the Central Committee's been doing. The Central Committee, the Republican Central Committee at the fair, unfortunately, we didn't have the language of the straw poll question A. We didn't even know it was question A. So we brought up the literature, you know, it's basic math. 5 minus 3 equals you lose.
Right.
You know, our goal has been since we, you know, this new committee took over in 2014, is to educate the public, to educate, you know, the people in the party. Because here now, the interesting thing is, this is not a partisan issue. This is a nonpartisan. Everyone's affected by this.
Right.
You know, this is a situation that we need to get out there and tell everyone that, hey, look, you have 5 votes.
Right.
Okay. This steals 3 of your votes, so you only have 2
right.
people. And it's about accountability. It's about accountability on 2 ways. If we like, you know, Commissioner Wilson's public opinion on the budget, his thoughts on how we're doing the budget, and we approve of that, everyone has the ability in the general election to vote him back into
county-wide,
office. County-wide.
Not just his district, and that's
Absolutely.
The key here. That's what we're talking about.
Absolutely.
Go ahead, Steve.
I'm sorry.
You had an important point you wanted to make.
I did?
Well, you did. You did. You wanted to kind of segue in what I was saying.
I was so lost in your eloquent oratory.
Very nice.
The point is fled for the moment, but keep on.
You know, I mean, for us, for the Republican Central Committee,
this is
the season. We're game on. We're less than 40 days from the general election, you know, but this is so important that this is a prime responsibility for us to get out to the public and say, you know, vote no to question A. You know, vote no. I mean, it's just...
Well, I recovered the point I was trying to make, which was that I don't think it's, you know, if we have 1,000 people see this, it would be a miracle.
Sure.
But so that what this is going to be a battle of road signs. It's going to be a battle of misinformation and non-information. And I think it's incredibly important for Republican Central or anybody that can do it to get signage and get info up, because it's so easy to, you know, vote for changing district voting. Will give you more of what you want. It's got a plausible sound, and it's got to be counteracted. And the only way to do that is this kind of public advertising.
Sure.
Right. And unfortunately, that ends up being costly, and it is a campaign of misinformation potentially out there, or it's sound bites.
50% of the people don't vote.
Yeah.
50% of the people are going fishing that day, they don't vote. 50%
right.
of the people don't vote. Let me say it one more time. 50% of the people don't vote.
They could
vote. They don't vote. Okay, so don't vote. What is the least participated area on the ballot? Oh, the questions. Why do you think that is? Most people don't have time or take time to educate themselves onto what the questions
right.
are. It's a very confusing thing. The further you go down the ballot, the less participation
right.
there is by the public of the 50% that choose to. By the time you get down the bottom, maybe you got 25% participation. So to change an election process with 25% participation, from something, one I cannot glean from my number of years being involved in these processes, what is supposed to be the benefit and what probably it corrects, I suggest to you that would be a very foolish enterprise to go under, because you know what you have now.
Right.
And it may not be perfect. But to go and exchange that for something with a number of unknowns that could, you can envision that a person who does not have the time and does not have the, could be, does not have the energy.
Or the resources.
Or does not have the money to run, well, okay, but they might be able to do that in one district.
Right.
Can you imagine how confusing, if there was 227 candidates that ran for county commissioner, you're still going to end up with five.
Yeah.
So I suggest to you, the more streamlined that process can be as far as a participation, I've been to forums before,
right,
where we had 22 people. So you get two questions, okay, good night. You get two questions, because everybody across the room, back and forth like this. I've seen 22 people stand beside me down the Kent Island Library and places like that. And if you don't like signs, boy, you won't like that, because then a person can take what would have been a countywide resource and consolidate them into an area, a much smaller area, and intensify it.
Sure.
And people just, it becomes more confusing.
Not only that, there are supposedly groups in this county that have money or that lean one way or another. Okay.
Yeah, sure.
You know what I mean? Growth or no growth. I'll just use that as
you
an example.
Your best interest.
Okay. Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And voting by district actually helps them out better, because let's say
they can buy it.
Well, they can buy it easily, because they only have to put money into three commissioners instead of five commissioners,
right,
because supposedly three commissioners control the board. So now it makes it easier for the money for these three, and they get to pick their choice.
Very, very true argument.
Yeah, and this is why, let me say something important here. This is why I really believe that there needs to be town hall meetings about this throughout this county for a period of time. You know, people need to understand, and people need to do that. That's why I think this is good. I may disagree with Steve. I think more than 1,000 people would see this. You know, I think 18,000 viewers are on this cable. I would like to think a majority of them will stop and take the time to listen, because I think we're trying to give the right information. We're not sitting here stabbing the other side about.
Well, Commissioner Buckey, if there should be town hall meetings, you know, our at-large commissioner really wholeheartedly supported this.
Then he should have town hall meetings.
No, he should. The county should pay for it if he pushed for it, and is one of the reasons why we're here today. How's that? Spoken like a citizen taxpayer. Why are we in the situation we're in? How do you educate?
So, in other words, he should pay for it, or the county?
I should say his district should pay
for
it, but he's the
at-large
commissioner. I'm saying that the county, unfortunately, like it or not, the county is in a position where the county citizens are going to be adversely impacted, unintended consequences, and the county actually should be educating the citizens.
I tell you, Barb, I just don't see it happening.
I don't see it happening.
I think we have
no, because there are special interests.
Well, we have, and the special interests are on all sides.
Right.
So, absolutely.
As a central committee, if you have an R next to your name, whether you're growth or no growth, I talk to you. That's mm-hmm. my job. My job is promoting party. I'm going to do a little shout out for my, you know, people on the central committee. Last year, we took a award for the mid-sized counties for the highest number of voters coming to the party. We've been working hard at educating. I mean, at the fair, if I handed out one of these, I handed out 500. And I can honestly say, if I had five people that spoke in favor of going to, as soon as people heard, they're taking my votes.
Right.
That's all you should
taking my
that's
votes.
Right.
Yeah.
That's we've gone the Safeway. I've gone to stores on the island. We primarily shop in our region. Sometimes we come to Centerville. And I've been in Centerville where I've been at the hardware store. And I've had citizens stop me and ask me about it. And I would explain it and say, well, they would go, well, that doesn't sound good to me.
Yeah.
That's not the way I interpreted it.
Sure.
You know, as Steve had said earlier, you know, no, it's going to be done this way. Well, you know, the last time I voted, I didn't like these commissioners, so I didn't vote for them, blah, blah, blah. But now you can't. Now you can't. Now you can only vote for yours and the at-large. So they didn't like that.
It's going to be awfully hard to gin up the vote. People always tell people to go out and vote, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Well, and if this were to pass and be adopted, you'd be saying, well, we only want two of your votes, not all five.
Right, there you go.
What incentive, if it's hard enough to get people to vote now, but if I can't vote for the majority of people that are supposed to be representing me, why should I vote at all?
Right.
Why would I even vote?
Well, I'll give you another
example. There's no reason to do it.
I agree. We operate as a unit, as Commissioner Wilson just said. We operate as a conclusive unit, a working engine, a well engine, and we make decisions based on the county. Mm-hmm. If this county's been very famous for not electing people back, and that's fine, okay? It is what it is. But mm-hmm. if you don't do a good job, and they don't like the sitting commissioners, well, everybody has a county right to kick them out. Well, it just happened in the last election. I mean, they didn't like, for whatever their reasons were, and they put in four new commissioners.
Sure.
That could happen again in 2 years, you know.
It generally does happen.
Yeah, well, it is what it is.
From the Central Committee's point on that stage, we're hoping that we re-elect commissioners that are sitting.
Absolutely.
Which will be the first time that we've had Republicans re-elected. I believe we can do it. I believe that there are many of you gentlemen that are doing the job that we're asking you as citizens, because I take my hat off as the chair, as a citizen, you know, you're spending my money wisely, and I, you know, you're holding the purse strings.
I've heard that from many people.
Look, as the
yes.
So, yes, some of us are.
And we're going to be doing a report card, mm-hmm. you know, and at the end of the day, it's going to be holding people accountable.
You got to understand, though, as the chairperson of the Redistricting Advisory Board, it didn't matter whether it was a Republican or a Democrat who was getting elected and we had an equal split on the board. It was who could be held accountable.
Right.
Yes.
Right. And what system would allow
yes.
the commissioners to be held accountable for mm-hmm. their actions mm-hmm. for the whole county
by
in
everyone.
Office by everyone. And you talk about voter turnout and ease of buying a district in a district that only has a 25% voter sure. turnout and people only.
And how does that represent, as Commissioner O'Donnell just said, if it's filtered down to 25, how does that represent the majority of the county's position?
Right.
It doesn't.
Look, and you look at the eight towns in the county, there are folks who are sitting in office who had no opposition because
sure.
they were willing to do the work and run for office, and everybody's like, yeah, that's yeah. fine. So what kind of turnout are we going to get
right.
if, yeah, so-and-so's running for office, great, you know?
Yeah, it's very disheartening when you have someone that, they display a certain way when we know, in fact, it's quite the opposite. You know, it's as the party chair, I look at who's elected and who's not elected. We're lucky enough to have Republicans straight across the board in this county, in the county positions. Not the same way in some of our municipalities, and our municipalities spread out in District 1 and District 2. But my hat does go off to the gentlemen and the ladies that are doing that, because most of them are doing it voluntarily.
Right.
It's hard work.
It's hard work.
You know, they want their piece of the pie, and we get that. But this is not the way there.
That's right.
This is just, I mean, it's bad legislation. It's bad math. You know, I mean, I sit back and I look, my whole thing is accountability.
Could you imagine now? I hate, you know, this is, you know, could you imagine if this system changes, which I don't think it will personally, but if it did, and you had five commissioners that were in these cities, okay, that on these are different towns we have that are commissioners now, and let's say that all five of them won. Could you imagine the amount of money that they can control to their municipalities if they chose
well,
to? 35%
of the population lives in the towns, and 65% are not town.
Right.
Correct.
I think one thing small. You can say fairly of this group, we all agree, this is not just a bad idea, it's a very bad
Absolutely.
Idea.
Absolutely.
And
yeah.
that I think if the public listens to this with thought and care, mm-hmm. they'll agree. I applaud you for gathering this group together,
Absolutely.
Sir.
I think that says it all
Good.
Right there.
It does.
Well, you know what? I thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being here. I'm going to go around the table real quick. If anybody wants to give a closing statement on something, I'll start with Tim.
Well, I'm going to say is, as the chair of the Republican Central Committee, and we've discussed this matter at length. In fact, we waited until it actually came out before we actually formed an official position. The Republican Central Committee does not believe that this is the way to go for our county. We would ask everyone to educate themselves. If you don't believe what we're saying, do the research. Go to Board of Elections, find out, you know, who got elected, who won in which district and polling places. The fact that you have special interests, and I believe special interests are truly behind this move. It may not be the face guys, but they're behind the face guys. We see that it has a possibility of bringing back Washington, D.C., pork barrel style politics, horse trading at its worst, and taking away when we take away a citizen's liberty, and I'm telling you, the liberty is the right to vote yes or no for or against this type of action. It's just wrong. It's not a Republican value. And we just want the people look, listen, learn, and vote your hearts.
George?
Yes, I didn't like this idea in my second term, and I like it equally as little now. I don't see any benefit from it. And we're talking about it this morning at a meeting. I have friends that serve on councils, I'll leave them nameless, in other areas, a good distance from here on the Eastern Shore. And they will tell you how it has undermined the efficiency of their government from the standpoint of, you've got to run, what did you do for me in my district? And it has caused that you create these fiefdoms of competition within. And to go through all this with those risks at hand, and you can have any size board you want. You can have any structure of government. You have the executive, you know, Queen Anne's County is one of the five counties that has code home rule, which is a good thing. There are others that got executive, and there's still commissioner forms. A lot of people think we're under commissioner form of government. It's not true. It's code home rule. But when you see the outcome of that in practice, hopefully it doesn't get to that point, because I think it would undermine a better system. Now you're going from what seems to be working as an adequate system now, but there is no substitute of any size or any structure that beats having good people. And the definition of a good person is a person that reflects your values and reflects your understanding and your service demands, okay? But then you would be telling these people, well, you can only vote for two of the five, so you don't get a choice of who the other three is going to be. And that's why this is a very bad thing.
Steve?
Well, I'm not inclined to try to summarize all the points we talked about during this thing, because in some ways to try to pack them all into two sentences diminishes them. But I think this is not a good plan at all. And I think it's clearly perilous to the political and well-being of the county, and that I hope the public thinks over very cautiously before they even consider changing a system that's been valuable over a long period of time and threatening to bring in one that they do not know or understand the consequences of, as do not the people that are even proposing it. And that I'm of the firm opinion that it wouldn't cure any problems that exist now, that we've had a really very fair distribution of assets and resources in the county for long years, and little reason to complain about unfairness, and that I'm strongly hopeful the public will understand that and vote the right way.
Barbara?
You know, to borrow a phrase from history, the system we have now has been developed by the people and for the people. It was developed by a diverse group of citizens for the best representation possible. To take away the ability to vote on that representation is taking away the representation itself across the county. Average citizens can run for office. They just need to commit to the time it takes to serve an office, and that is the scariest thing about serving an office. That's what we need, is to be able to find more citizens who are able to take the time to serve in office. If you want your representation to be different, turn up, vote, but for this, vote no.
beg the citizens to research this and look into this extremely well. Talk to other commissioners, councilmen throughout the state of Maryland, people you may know. This is not a good system. This was a system brought on by this past election. I'm convinced of that. I'm not trying to throw names or bust or, you know, fingers at any one group or anything, but I'm convinced that there were some people upset that certain people got elected, spent the money that they spent. I will rerun for commissioner again. I'm going to make that announcement now. You know, I probably shouldn't do it on this show, but I will rerun, but I won't spend the nearly amount of money that I spent the last time, if a quarter of that, but I will run countywide and not just my district, for the reason is I represent Queen Anne's County. When I go to functions, I don't go in there and say I'm District 3 commissioner. I go and say I'm a Queen Anne's County commissioner for District 3. You know, I represent this entire county. It's extremely important for the citizens to do their research and know what they're getting into.